Hallelujah. Happy is the man who fears the Lord, taking great delight in his commands. His descendants will be powerful in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and the riches are in his house, and his righteousness endures forever. His light in the darkness for the upright, he is gracious, compassionate, and righteous. God will come to a man who lends generously and conducts his business fairly. He will never be shaken. The righteous man will be remembered forever. He will not fear bad news. His heart is confident, trusting in the Lord. His heart is assured. He will not fear. In the end, he will look in triumph on his foes. Thank you.
Fathers like Orioles are layered in love, with three divine callings from heaven above. Standing as head of the home, he presides by example and faith. He nurtures and guides by the sweat of his brow. He provides for our needs, earning a living. He shelters, clothes, feeds the third like the layer of icing between. He protects us from danger and all things unclean. Presiding, providing, protecting, and more are just some of the layers we love our dads for. Happy Father's Day.
We wanted to bless the fathers today. So, men of God, happy Father's Day. So, I had some beautiful women of God that helped me through this weekend because I was out of town. So, they baked for me some fresh Oreo cookies for you. Amen. So, enjoy. So, when you walk out, grab your Oreo cookie.
Amen. And those of you who don't like Oreos, well, I'll take them. Amen. You know what? I just want to just... Before I call up our pastor, you know what? We have men that, we have people that are not here, but you know, they're out having lunch or whatever, but I want to tell you, you know what? Those of you who are watching us out there who chose not to come today to go have lunch, you know what? You're missing out on the best meal today here. The bread of life is going to be served up today. The bread of life will sustain and nourish you throughout the whole day. You know, that meal that you're going to have today might be good for a minute, but this bread of life is going to be engraved, tattooed on the tables of our heart. We're going to have it ready when the opportunity calls for us to use that word. Amen. So I encourage you out there, you know what? Come to church. Those places are open after church. Come to church. Get fed the word of God, the bread of life, which will sustain and nourish you. Amen. With that being said, let's put our hands together and welcome our shepherd up. Amen. Come on now.
Praise the Lord. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers in the place. And thank you, Jesus, for everybody else for being here. I'm excited. I'm choked up in the video. It's, wow, that's awesome. And thank you for those who participated in that. That's just awesome. I loved it. God is good. Something about the Father's love. Something about it that just... When that's absent, then it is, most of the time it's quite evident. But I'm just glad to be in the house of the Lord and happy to dwell with the congregants. The Bible says that I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of our God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. That's a heavy statement right there, but that's a true statement. I'm grateful and thankful for those that have made their way in here today. How about the worship? Amen. It sounded like an army, like a massive choir. Amen. It's just awesome. The presence of God was definitely in this place. And again, I'm grateful that you could take the time and to celebrate this wonderful day today. Well, with no further ado, let's open up our Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy. Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 6. And before I go on with this, let's keep in mind and keep in prayer for the revival coming up in August. Not only our Harvesters Conference, in Baldwin Park, but our own first three-day revival. It's in August. It's soon approaching. It's the last week of August, I believe, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, the last week, 25th, 26th, and 27th. And I've been praying for a theme for that, and I haven't told anybody, but I got it this morning, and it's going to be rebuilding the walls for revival. That's going to be our theme, and I believe I have the speakers in prayer. I haven't notified anyone, but I have some names in mind, and with the help of men of God that are advisors in this place, you know, they not only provoke me, but just, you know, just it's wise counsel. So that stimulated things that were in me spiritually to get down and ask God for those things. Well, with no further ado, let's again turn our Bibles to the book of Deuteronomy chapter 6 on this Father's Day. Hallelujah. Deuteronomy chapter 6. We're going to begin reading in verse 1. I thought Zion was stealing my message. Now this is the commandment, and these are the statutes and the judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them in the land which you are crossing over to possess, that you may fear the Lord your God to keep his commandments, the statutes which I command you and your son and your grandson, all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged. Therefore hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it, that it may be well with you, and that you may multiply greatly as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you, a land flowing with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. Verse 7 says, you shall teach them diligently to your children, and you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. Verse 8 says, you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and there shall be as and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gate. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you once again, Lord. And we pray that your spirit would continue to move in this place, Lord. We pray right now that your word, God, that changes everything, Lord, would land on fertile ground. We thank you, Father, for your presence. We thank you, Lord, for the assignment that you have given us, Lord. We thank you and we're grateful, Father, for all that you have blessed us with. We're grateful for this day. We're grateful for our families, Lord. We want to give you thanks in advance for what you're going to do, Lord, this afternoon. And we're careful to give you all the praise and all the glory is yours, and all the saints of God say amen and amen. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There it is. Of course, today being Father's Day, I want to speak to the dads. But I know as I'm saying that, there's somebody in here that saying, well, I'm not a dad. But if you're a man in this place, there's a good possibility you could be one day. Or maybe you're a single parent in this place and not a dad. But I think this applies to parenting in general. So I believe this message is very, very applicable and informative. And I want to speak on the influence of a godly father. Part of the reason of this message is so critical is because we live in a society that is so increasingly devalues the masculinity of manhood. Every sitcom that we turn around or turn on, it portrays fathers as being silly little boys. And fathers often are portrayed as beer gut guzzlers in the sitcoms that we watch. And masculinity makes a difference. Let me share this with you, that 60% of youth suicides are from fatherless homes. 90% of all runaway children are from fatherless homes. 85% of children with behavioral disorders are from fatherless homes. 71% of high school dropouts are from fatherless homes. 75% of all adolescents' chemical abuse patients are from fatherless homes. 85% of all youths that wind up in prison are from fatherless homes. These are results that are shocking, but they're not surprising. And let me say this so that everybody here is on the same page here. The mother's role is very, very important, and we know that. It is not a matter of being one or the other being more important than the other. What it is, it's a matter of that God has designed the roles to serve in a complementary fashion and together to reflect the nature and the person and the heart of God in a way that neither person on their own can do. The mother's roles will always be primarily in the terms of intimacy, care, and nurturing. But the fact of the matter is, as a child matures, he or she will increasingly look to the father for the role model in processing decisions. I believe Pastor Richard spoke on that. And adopting the values that they will have. This, in fact, is a statistic that can be proven. And where the father is indifferent or inadequate or just plain absent, that task for maturing in a responsible manner becomes much harder for the child. And growing spiritually is no different. Studies show that if a father that does not go to church, even if his wife does, only one child in 50 will become a regular worshiper. Maybe you're a single mom and you're saying, where does that leave me? Can I encourage you today that God delights in doing exceptional things in the life of people who believe he can do it? You're believing that you're going to be that exception. And I know how you're feeling. I myself was raised by a single mother. When you're left in that type of a situation, God is going to help you to do what needs to be done in any of your situation. The goal of that statistic is not to harden anybody or to grieve anybody, but you yourself could give testimony that living that sort of life is difficult. If you're doing it on your own, statistics say that the father regularly attends church. If one does, Even if the mother does not, 66% of the children will attend church. When both husband and wife both attend the church, 75% of the children will become regular attenders. All of that to say this, we are not talking luxuries here. We're talking necessities. When we need a generation of godly men that understand the importance of being an influential godly father, because the fact of the matter is that you can produce a family, but that doesn't make you a mate. And you can be a male, but that doesn't make you a man. And I want to say this to especially dads today, that the way we live our lives, the way we lead in our homes, it will have an effect on our children. It will have an effect on our marriage. It will have an effect in our lives. And we're going to see it will have an effect on generations to come. That's what we're talking about today because it's so very, very important. I want to talk to you today about the Word of God. That's our basis and our foundation for living today. And for all life, and certainly for parenting, My concern is as we talk about the Word of God, if we don't balance it with some other things that should also go along with it in the Word of God, the end result might not be favorable for the children or for our home. And what I mean by this, that if a father takes the message on the Word of God, but implements it like a dictator or unkind, unwise, without operating in humility, it's not going to help at all. All I'm saying is it has to be applied with wisdom. We must have a relationship with our children. Some parents make the mistake by thinking love is the same thing as influence. That's just simply not true. I know a lot of parents that love their children but have very little influence on them. The formula is something like this: love with time equals relationship. You cannot have influential relationship unless you're spending time with your kids. Can I hear an amen? The mistake, especially a father can make, is to somehow see that the younger years are the domain of the mothers, to leave them to nurture. It's the mother's responsibility when they're younger. The fact of the matter is, a relationship with your children starts when they're very young. Spending time with them while they're still young, you're investing relational relationships when they're still young. Our children are looking up to you, or they're looking up to us. You will make the most of that and take advantage of that regardless of their age. You're the parent. It's not their job to enter into your world. It's your job to enter into theirs. Parenting has to be done in humility. It has to be done where we recognize our responsibility as parents, to humbly accept the fact and acknowledge it in front of them that we're not perfect, because they already know that. You're going to fall beneath the grounds of the standard of the Word of God, each and every one of us. How you respond in that moment is everything. It's critical on whether you're going to have influence on your children. Let's use this as an example. You can imagine as a pastor, and your children are watching you preach, but they're also watching you live. They're certainly aware of the moments where the two don't match. Hello, somebody. Are you with me? How we acknowledge that and we don't ignore it, or we just move on or act like it didn't even happen, even when they're small. So it might work something like this, where you're going to have to go up and you're going to have to explain. And you might say to him, you know, this is, you know, I did something wrong. I may have talked to your mom the wrong way. I may have handled the situation the wrong way. And you explain to them at a young age. And you begin, and you're down to their level, to where you can say, "And will you forgive me?" Of course, not without approaching your spouse to get that straight first. But we can't neglect the fact, because they're young, they're going to overlook it. It's not the way it happens. You got to let them know that you're committed to the spouse and that you love them. And if you don't do that, eventually your children, they'll view you as a hypocrite, and they'll turn you off. That being said, I want to talk to you about being a godly father. A godly father leaves a legacy. How we live today not only affects today or tomorrow or the next few months, But how you and I live has a generational effect. The way you and I serve God will echo through the decades. And if the Lord tarries, it'll echo through the centuries. You're shaping your family by the way you live. You may have come from a family that never had that. So now you're starting a new legacy, a new generation, a new godly heritage of blessings. When we come to Deuteronomy chapter 6, Moses is at the end of his life. And Moses is having led the nation of Israel through the deserts for 40 years. Most of us know that. Moses now is reminding the people of the last 40 years and how God has brought them to this point. And he reminds them about their priorities and their attentions to the law, to their obedience of the law. He tells them in Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 22, remember that out of all the people that were in the world, in the history of mankind, you guys heard the voice of God. You guys audibly heard the voice of God. Some of you in here maybe say, man, that would be cool to hear God's voice. But let me remind you what their statement was when they heard the voice of God. This was their take on it. After that happened, the people went to Moses and said, don't ever let that happen again. They said, we almost died when we heard the voice of God. They didn't know how to act. They heard the voice of God unfiltered. His holiness, his righteousness, the power of God made them think that they were going to die. I wish I had a Bible reader in the house. And they said, if that happens again, we're probably going to die. So they said to God, go talk to Moses. And then Moses can talk to us. And here's what God said about it. In Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 29. Oh, that they had such a heart in them that they would fear me and always keep my commandments, that it might be well with them and with their children forever. Did you hear that? If you and I have a heart for God, it will have an effect on generations to come. Certainly it's going to affect you. It's going to affect you and your walk with God. And it's going to bless, and it's going to bless me, and it's going to bless you. But it's going to affect my kids. It's going to affect my children, your grandkids. It will affect generations. And if it doesn't affect them negatively here, it affects them positively, he says. Positively. They're going to prosper. That's what he said. We're reminded because Joshua, this is what happens within months when Moses wrote this in Joshua chapter 1. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and you will have good success. You want to know how to prosper? You want to know how to live a successful life? Meditate on the Word of God day and night. Open your Bible. Not only open your Bible, do what it says. This is what Moses was telling the people. So get in the Word of God. Think about it. Obey it. And watch what happens in your life. Then you will make your way prosperous. Then you will have good success. God says, if you honor me in my word, I'll honor you. This is what the Lord is telling them. What's going to happen is I'm going to bless you in such a way that you're going to prosper. That's a promise from God. In a way that's going to make you successful.
So, Dad, there's a legacy that you could leave your children. It's more powerful. It's more important. It's better than stocks and bonds. Is knowing the Word of God and living for Almighty God. That's better than life. Now let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 1 through 3. It says, now this is the commandment, and these are the statutes and judgments which the Lord your God has commanded to teach you, that you may observe them in the land which you are crossing over to possess, that you may fear the Lord your God to keep all his statutes and his commandments which I command you. First of all, how are you going to respect something that you don't know nothing about? A lot of us are living and walking and doing things because we don't know the Word of God. The only time we open up our Bibles is on Sunday. Or we don't even open them up, we just look at the screen. But how are we going to know to fear? The word fear here represents, in Hebrew, it represents respect. Because we read, we believe, the Word of God is living, it's active, it does something in a man's or woman's heart that totally changes their makeup. And it says, if you do this, as you're crossing over, some of you are crossing over. Some of you are right there at your breakthrough. You're crossing over. But do you have the fear of the Lord? That you may fear the Lord your God, keep his commandments, which I command you, and your son and your grandson all the days of your life, and that your days may be prolonged. Statistics prove you'll live a longer life if you obey the Word of God, if you fear the Lord. Verse 3 says, then, therefore, O hear, O Israel, and be careful to observe it, that it may be well with you. How many want to be made well? How many are tired of the same old, same old? And that you may multiply greatly as the Lord God of your fathers has promised you, a land flowing with milk and honey. Hallelujah. Proverbs 9, 10 and 11 says, fear of the Lord is the foundation of wisdom. Knowledge of the Holy One results in good judgment. You tired of making dumb mistakes? You tired of making the wrong mistakes? It's in the Word of God. It says, wisdom will multiply your days and add years to your life. What happens is when you're living a godly life, you make the kind of decision that leads to longevity. That's what happens. Proverbs 22:4 says, true humility and the fear of the Lord leads to riches and long life. You like that? Watch this. This is interesting. It leads to riches, honor, and long life. Solomon's saying, you know what, I'm watching this and something happens about a man who fears the Lord. Something happens when somebody fears the Lord, they respect it, they're in their word, they read it, something happens. The Lord blesses that. So I got to put it in paper, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Somebody's going to catch this. If we obey, if we keep the commandments, if we fear God, not only is it's going to be well, but it's going to be well with your children and for generations to come. Hallelujah. Somebody got to give the Lord a hand of praise. He said some things commonly happen to people who love the Lord. This comes from the wisest man in the world. This is what he sees. God elevates those that love him. He loves to show off his beloved. And I also notice that he seems to do well financially. Hallelujah. That's the word of God. That's not prosperity preaching. This is from the word of God. You make better decisions. And they do better than people who don't. And they seem to live longer. Pretty simple. Listen, you live for God and you model for God, He will honor that. This could give your children a legacy to remember you by. Notice that it also says that it may go well with you. It is saying that when a person honors God, God said to Joshua, if you meditate on these words, keep these words, live in these words, what's going to happen is you're going to be successful and you're going to prosper. That's what he's telling Joshua. Can I tell you that it pays to read the Word of God? You like that? I don't think that most people think of it that way, or that I don't think, at least I don't, but I know what it produces. I know what it says. Should I just do it just to prosper? Got the wrong idea. But I'm just saying, don't just ask me, read the Word of God. Obey the Word of God. Obey the commandments of God. Will reading it benefit you financially? Yes, if you live it. Will it benefit you relationally? Yes, if you live it. Will it benefit you when opportunities arise? Yes, if you live it. I'm just saying, the Bible says it will go well with you. And with all generations. When I'm reading the Bible, I'm literally investing in my kids. I'm not only investing in myself, I'm literally investing in my kids and in generations to come. That's what the Word of God is saying. I'm investing in my family's future. It's true, if you're doing it, it makes a difference. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 2 and 2 says it this way, that it works. When a person is blessed by the Lord, it's like the blessing is just spilling over to whoever is around. That's how God does it. If you live for God, then He begins to expand your territory. Come on, somebody. There's a spillover blessing. My cup runneth over. You ever heard that? So, Dad, what legacy are you leaving your children? I ask you again, what legacy are you leaving your children? Because you're leaving one. And let me just say this today. God, dads, thank you for being here. You made the right choice. You made an important choice. You just didn't stumble in here. I don't know where you're at in your spiritual walk, in your spiritual journey. You might be new to this. You might be somewhat interested. I don't know. You might be flowing with the flow. But your being here is huge. It makes a massive difference in your children's life for generations to come. And I think it says a lot about the church, because honestly, Father's Day is statistically the lowest attendance day of the calendar. I read this weekend, matter of fact. You see, your obedience to the Lord, or lack of, determines what your children and grandchildren what they'll know if they serve God. It'll play a big dividend in their life. You're either creating a legacy for them of blessings, or you're laying a foundation of groundwork for a life full of hardship. You're either doing one of the two. Because what you do has a huge effect on them. Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 5 says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, and with all your soul and your strength." In order to train up godly children, they have to see a godly parent. Or parents, preferably, who are completely and totally in love with God. That's what they got to see. Parents who lead within and are not asking children to do something that they're not doing. That's what they're looking for. Who are saying to their kids, "I do the things," when in fact they don't. So Moses gave us some instructions here on what it means to love God. So in the same chapter, in verse 5, it says, how do we love God? With all our heart. You ever love something with all your heart and you've done anything in your power to get it? Nobody here. So first of all, Moses says we have to love the Lord with all our heart. Our kids know that we're not perfect. They already know that. What they want to know is if you're sincere, if you're the real deal. That's what they want to know. That you're really trying, you're striving. You're just not role-playing. You're just not clocking in. You're not something here and something different at home. And dads, what we have trouble relating to is our openness and showing our love for God. Women have no trouble in this. Women have no trouble showing others or outwardly that they love God. But for whatever reason, men have trouble portraying or showing their love for God. We seem to think that it's a women thing. Dads, what your children need to see is passion from the heart. That you're sold out for God. If you're not sold out for God, you're sold out for something else. They need to see you wholeheartedly in love, passionately in love with God. More than anything else, or more than anyone else. They need to see that. That you're committed to Him sincerely with all your heart. With all your soul. That's when people can see that it's obvious in your life. It's obvious where you spend your time. It's obviously in your calendar. It's obvious. It's obvious in your checkbook. Got even more quiet. I felt hearts drop. It's obvious in your speech. In the way you communicate, the way you interact. They got to believe that serving and loving God is a big deal. Is a special thing. You want to model that for your kids. That we love the Lord and that we serve the Lord. And that we delight in doing it. We don't have to do it. We get to do it. We love to do it. That's what we have to model. With all your might, with all your physical strength, with all your emotional strength, we love to serve the Lord. Your intellectual strength. Here's why it's important to dads, because you cannot pass on what you don't have. That's why it's so critical for us to get it first as men, as men of God, as fathers. We cannot teach or pass on what we don't have. It ain't gonna happen. Here's the most important we want for the kids. Or at least this should be your number one priority of what you want for your kids. Is to fall in love with the Lord. It's to love the Lord passionately. Whatever they do, you don't have to shove it down their throat or tell them to do this or to do that in whatever field they choose. If they love the Lord, God will take care of them. That should be the number one priority. Not pushing them to college, not pushing them to the career that has the most digits. Little Johnny has a 40-acre, 3 swimming pools, but he's going to go to hell? He's got to be in love, or she, in love with the Lord. That's the number one. That should be your number one priority. Not only for the children, but the people that you love. It's to be passionate, to fall in love with God. Not to push them into ministry, because you didn't call them. God calls them. And it may not be their line. It may be a life of hardship for them. But if God has called them, then that's the best job they could have. But it has to be from God. So that has to be our number one concern, that they love the Lord with all their heart, mind, soul, strength. Because if you don't, nothing else is going to matter. You ever heard that saying where Jesus said, I'm the true vine. Apart from me, you can do nothing. You've been here, you know I use that. I struggle with that. God, I can do things. Oh, yeah. What you're doing is nothing. Or if it's something, it'll amount to nothing. Yeah, you're right, Lord. It'll turn to nothing. Everything that pulled you, that you work for, that you strive for, that you had vision for, in the end, you'll have a mouthful of gravel if the Lord is not in it. and you'll know a lot of heartache. Having lived life, I know that nothing really matters without the Lord. And if they don't love God, nothing but problems will arise in every aspect of their life. Deuteronomy 6:6 says, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart." You see, there has to be a conviction. Otherwise, it won't get done. Are you hearing me? We do in our lives what we think is most important. Can I get a witness? We do in our lives what we think is most important. Our convictions determine our decisions. 6 chapter 6 verse 6 says, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart." If it's not in your heart, you're going to have very little impact on your kids. If it's not in your heart, you're going to have very little impact on people. If you want to teach children, it's got to be real to you first. One amen. You can't teach something that you don't know. You got to be passionate about it. And we have to be consistent. Verse 7 says, "You shall teach them diligently to your children." Not just told them about it. Not just, "I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I just die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to keep." They're good. Remember that? Diligently teach them. Not tell them. Diligently teach them. Always finding an opportunity, not shoving things down their throat, finding an opportunity to minister to your children. "And you shall talk of them when you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up." You repeat it. You reinforce it. You look for areas of your life to minister. That's what Moses was saying. You're going to talk about it all the time. Because if you're not talking about the Lord, you're talking about somebody or something anyway. You got to invest while you're young. Build a relationship with him. Verse 8 says, "You shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes." It's got to be in your mind. It's got to be tunnel vision. Your mind's got to be locked in. Always ready for the word. Not just when you're writing a sermon or you're called to give a devotion, but you open up your Bible. And dad, if you're not doing these things, ask the Lord to keep you or put you back on track. Because it's bigger than just you. It's about the legacy that you'll leave. It's about loving the Lord with all your heart. It's about leading those to follow in your footsteps. And if you're going to do that, then you're going to be blessed. You're going to prosper. You're going to live a life of longevity. Because the hand of God was on your life. I'm closing in verse 9. "You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gate." Matter of fact, you should be a walking billboard for Christ. Let's give the Lord a hand of praise. And if the world doesn't think you're a little crazy, then you ain't doing your job. Remember when you were in the world and you, when they came up to you? Thought, what the heck are they talking about? I could never do that. What am I going to do for fun? I can't do this no more. I can't do that. You guys ain't that saved. But the fact of the matter is there's not enough time to do what the Lord puts in your heart. There's not enough time. Let's all stand. I want to end where I left, where I began. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers, and I pray that you'll be blessed, that this word ministered to you, that it makes you take the time to reflect and look at where you're at in life. Bible says that we didn't choose God, but He chose us. And He ordained us that we should bear fruit. And fruit that should last. Best part of that verse is, it says, and when you do that, you can ask the Father in my name, and He'll give it to you. You're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ. You're here today and maybe somebody invited you. You're here today and maybe your life has gone wayward. I want to lead you in a prayer. You're here today and you've never received Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. I want to ask by a showing of hand that so that I can pray for you. Anybody here don't know Christ? Anybody here hasn't received Jesus within their heart? Hallelujah. First part here of the altar call is for the fathers. You're in this place. And the Word of God ministered to you. You're in this place and you realize that there's an adjustment that we have to make, some greater than others. But the best part is we recognize it's the Holy Spirit. Jesus said He came here to convict the world of their sin. Pastor Richard said, do you hate your sin? And then he repeated it about a couple times and more. It was more intense every time he said it. I don't know about you. It was like, wow. When Jesus told Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? Because the Bible says that we didn't come into the light because we loved our darkness. But Jesus is the light, truth and the way. Nothing greater. His strength is greater than anything than we could even imagine. Yes, the walls will fall in some areas and the chains will break. But there is some building of the walls that need to take place. Before we step into revival, there's got to be a building for revival. Before the message was preached, the word consecration came. We must consecrate ourselves. We must separate ourselves. We must position ourselves for purity in the Lord. If we want to hear from God, if we want to have true revival, if we want to see the sinner get saved, if we want to see our family come in, if we want to see things, if we want to see the hand of God move, We got to set apart from that unclean thing. Hallelujah. You're here today. And you want to recommit your vow of being a father, a dad that will follow the ultimate father. I want to open up this altar and I want to pray for you. Come. Don't look, because we all fall short. Hallelujah. The altars are open. Come. I want to pray for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. The Bible says if we confess our sins to one another, there's a cleansing. I don't know. I don't want to know the detail. I just want you to acknowledge that you fall short, that we fall short. We don't have to go into detail. God knows all things. Repentance is turning from there. And fathers, dads, you're at this altar. Repeat after me. Say, Jesus, I believe that with you, nothing is impossible. I give you my heart. I give you my life. Take full control. Give me the wisdom to make the decisions that I need to make that honor you. I need your strength. I need your discernment. Lead me and guide me. Lord, I empty myself that you would fill me with your goodness. You're a miracle working God. And I'm going to thank you in advance for what you're going to do in my life. In the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen. Stand right there. Stand right there. I want to pray for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, right now activate. Oh, the Spirit of the living God lives in you. From the top of his head to the soles of the